Feeling like taking a coffee break? So do I. What about we talk again about the JEP 395 about records? We already talked about records in a previous JEP Café, and I had very nice feedback and comments from you with several questions, so thank you for that. So what about we visit this topic again, compare records with other data classes from other languages and frameworks, namely Kotlin and Lombok, especially from the performance perspective, and talk about record serialization. First of all, just a quick recap, what is a record? Maybe you already know that a record is a class that carries an immutable state. And if this is all you know about records, maybe you think that it's a nice feature, but also pretty useless because you have Lombok or Kotlin and you can already do that in other ways. Well, it turns out that a record is a little more than that, and it can bring you features that have no equivalent anywhere else, neither in Kotlin, neither in Lombok. First thing you need to know, a record is built on the components. These are the parameters that you give when you declare a record. These components are compiled as final fields, and they are the only fields that you can have in a record. You cannot add any other instance fields in a record. If you try to do that, you will get a compiler error. Second, a record is a final class, so no state can be added by extending a record class. And a record already extends the class java.lang.record, so it cannot extend another class. So in a nutshell, no state can be added to a record through inheritance. It means that when you look at the declaration of a record, the components that you see are the state of the record. There is no way you can add another field to these components. In a way, it also means that it breaks encapsulation because a record exposes its internal state. But we don't really care about that. The compiler can create a default constructor for you based on this state that takes the component of a record. This constructor is called the canonical constructor of a record. One very important principle with several consequences is that you cannot build a record instance without calling its canonical constructors. We are going to see these consequences. Of course, you can redefine this canonical constructor and write your own. Why would you do that? Well, there are two main use cases. The first one, you need to store defensive copies of the arguments passed to this constructor because they are mutable. Think about arrays, about lists, about dates, for instance. And the second one is you want to validate the arguments to prevent the creation of non-valid, corrupted records. In both cases, make sure to properly initialize the fields of the records. If you forget to do that, the compiler will catch you. But if you don't really need to initialize these fields because there is no defensive copy, only validation, then you can also use another constructor called the compact constructor, which is a nice syntax that makes your code even more readable. In that case, you do not need to explicitly initialize the state of your record. The compiler will take care of that for you. Of course, having a canonical constructor does not prevent you from creating more constructors. All you need is to make sure that at the end of the day, these constructors called the canonical constructor. And apart from that, a record can implement any interface, for instance comparable, so in that case, you will be able to sort a list of population records. We will talk more about the canonical constructor in a minute, when we talk about serialization. But before that, I would like to talk more about the other elements the compiler creates for you. In a range record, for example, the compiler creates two accessors, begin and end. Be careful because they do not follow the Java bean convention. If you still need the classical getters of the Java bean, you can still create them by hand. You can also write your own accessors. This is especially useful if you need to expose defensive copies of the fields of your records. The classical trilogy toString equals and hashCode are also generated by the compiler for you. Now, this is a very interesting point. Let us examine it closely and compare how records are handling these methods with what data classes from Kotlin and Lombok are giving you. If you check the bytecode generated by the Java compiler, you see that the compiled code calls invoke dynamic, meaning that the actual code is not in the bytecode of the record. In a future version of the JDK, if the implementation of the hashCode method, for instance, is optimized, your records will benefit from it without you having to recompile your code. This is a big difference with what you get when you use data classes from Kotlin or Lombok, for instance. The code compiled by the Kotlin compiler is the code of a classical final class. From the bytecode point of view, a Kotlin data class is just a plain final class with final fields. And the same goes for Lombok. If you compare a record with this class, annotated with the data annotation provided by the Lombok framework, you will see that the toString method takes advantage of the makeConcat with constants method added in JDK 9, but that the hashCode and the equals method are both implemented in a bytecode. So, if you need to leverage some future improvements, you will have to recompile this code. The performances are not the same between records, Lombok and Kotlin, when it comes to equals and hashCode computation. Here is an example computed on the following record, holding just 5 strings of characters. Let us first evaluate the performances of the hashCode implementation. We fill this record with random strings of characters, and we can see, on the same elements, that we have about a 50% difference between a classical record and the equivalent Kotlin data class. In fact, it's a 2-nanosecond difference, so even if it is significant, it's not that much. Lombok is really behind, with an implementation that is 3 times slower. For the equals method, things are a little more tricky. So we have 4 cases for the equals method. First, let us call equals on 2 objects that are the same instances. So these objects are equals in the equal-equal sense. We expect to have the 3 implementations to behave the same because they probably compare instances with equal-equal. And indeed, they do. Second use case, let us call this equal method with 2 instances that have the same fields, but in different instances. So the result of the call is true. The record implementation is about 25% faster than the Kotlin one, which is in fact only 1 nanosecond. So that's really a tiny difference, even if it is significant. Lombok is way behind with an implementation that is more than 5 times slower. Third, we compare 2 objects that are just different. All the fields are different. So seeing that they are different should be fast. It should happen on the first of the 5 fields. The record implementation and the Kotlin implementations are almost the same, where the Lombok implementation is about 50% slower. That's about 3 nanoseconds, so not too bad, but still significant. And the last bench consists in comparing objects that are different, but almost the same. In fact, their first fields are the same. The only difference is in the last fields of the 5. This should have an impact on the computation of the equals method. And we can see that the results are consistent with the rest of the benchmark, with records performing a little better than the Kotlin data classes and Lombok significantly behind by a factor of more than 5. So, on the overall, this implementation difference has indeed an impact on the performances of your code. These differences may not be an issue for you, and they may change in the future. But I still think that it's good to know, you know, just in case. The last point I would like to talk to you about is serialization. One of the problems of serialization in Java is that when you deserialize an object, no constructor is ever called. So, if you are in a situation where the constructor of the object you want to rebuild contains some validation code, this validation is bypassed. So, imagine the following. You have a range class with a validation rule that makes sure that the begin field is lesser than the end field. And you need to serialize some instances of this class. You may feel protected by the validation rules you put in the constructor of this class, but in fact, you are not. If a corrupted serialize range object with a begin field greater than the end field reaches your deserialization layer, it will be deserialized, bypassing your validation rule. And bad things may happen in your application because now you have a corrupted object to deal with. Now, you may remember the rule with record. The canonical constructor is always called when a record is built, even during the deserialization process. So the previous situation cannot happen with records. Now, how can you leverage that feature without having to refactor all your legacy transport objects to record? Well, there is a mechanism baked in the serialization process, which is called writeReplace, readResolve. And this mechanism can be used here. Suppose that you have a range class. Let us call it RangeLegacy. And this range class comes with a validation rule, and you need to serialize your RangeLegacy object. What you can do is just create a range record with only the fields you need to transport. And of course, you call the same validation rule from the canonical constructor of this record. And then you can add a special method to your range legacy class that tells the serialization process, hey, instead of serializing me, just serialize this object I am giving you. This method is called writeReplace. You need to create it very precisely with the exact elements that are here. It must return an object, and it must throw the object stream exception. To make sure that the compiler correctly recognized the method you create, starting with the JDK 14, you can add the serial annotation on it. The compiler will warn you if this method is not recognized. So now your serialized stream or file will contain records instead of instances of your legacy range class. How can the deserialization recreate your range legacy class? For that, you need another method in your record called readResolve. Same as the previous one, it needs to be exactly like this one, returning an object and throwing this object stream exception. The deserialization process will first recreate your record instances, and they we call the canonical constructor, so no more corrupted records in this stream of objects. The validation rule you put in the canonical constructor will be called. And once the range record have been deserialization, the deserialization process will say, oh, there is a readResolve method here, let me call it. This method can then create your range legacy instance safely by calling the right constructor and the right validation rule. This is your code and you can do whatever you want. So the cost of the refactoring is not that big. It's just one record to create and two small methods to add. WriteReplace in your legacy data object and readResolve in that record. This extra layer of validation makes records a very good choice to implement your data transport objects. If you need to secure your code in that way, then using records is your only choice. There is no equivalent, neither in Kotlin nor in Lombok. And with this, I'm out of coffee, so that's it for today. Talk to you soon.